Hi, Partha.
Yes, hi. We have connected. Good.
Excellent. Yeah, good. Well, first of all, thank you for taking the time to be interviewed by me and
Pleasure.
be part of this series. It's nice to see you first face to face.
Same here. Absolutely. We've corresponded considerably over this last 1 year or so. Yes, it's a pleasure.
Great. Well, I'd like to, you probably know the format of my interviews, Partha. So I'd like to go through basically your intellectual career, really, and we start with your childhood and work from there. And we also talk maybe about certain non-intellectual matters as they crop up. But it's really to give viewers a flavor of how you became the thinker you became and what were the key influences and the main aspects of your outlook and how they developed. So that's how we'll proceed, I think. And we can go down various detours. I don't have a strong view about how we go, but we'll start with your childhood and work all the way to the present. That's the aim.
That's fine. That's
Okay, great. Well, in that case, if we can, maybe if you could give us an insight into, where you were born, when you were born, and your parents.
Well, I was born in Dhaka, which was at that time in United India, in East Bengal, but then subsequently became part of Pakistan, 1947, when subcontinent split into two political units, and then became part of Bangladesh in 1971 when Pakistan split into two. It's the capital of Bangladesh today. I gather it was a bustling town, but I wouldn't know. We left when I was about three and a half, I think, or three, for in what became India just before partition in 1946. I was born on in November 1942, during the war years.
Okay. Did the war impact? Did you hear anything about from your family or parents? Had the war impacted India, or did you feel it, or was it felt by your parents?
Well, the war, it wasn't so much, I can't say in all truthfulness it was the war which affected my parents, in as much, except in as much as, of course, running the household must have been very hard for my mother. They were not well off anyway, but I mean they were okay. My father was a university lecturer, but he had huge commitments towards his eldest brother, who had supported him when he was very young and allowed him to go to university and everything. So there were some family obligations, plus he had a huge debt to the university for having borrowed money to go to London to do his PhD. So it must be the price rises, the inflation that took place must have been very hard for my mother, because she managed the household. My father didn't. And she was very, very good about that, good on that. But I think the partition, that affected them enormously. Absolutely no question about it, because they were Bengalis and they had no other intention but to live their life in Dhaka, where he was a lecturer, and he was hoping that he would retire from there. And all our friends were there, but all that whole life crashed essentially. And they left in 1946 before partition. And in some sense, I would say my father certainly did never really got over it. I mean, he wasn't moaning about it, but he never did. That's not the issue. But I think his heart lay in Bengal. And my mother's heart lay wherever my father was. So that was not a problem. I mean, well, it was a problem, but if you see what I mean.
Yes.
Did I feel anything? No, I was too young. I
Okay.
was protected. So no, I have no memories of the war, but of riots or civil disturbances, I do have memories of. I could come to that later.
Okay, very good. So you moved. I mean, what were your parents like? Were they strict, or were they religious, or were they dogmatic? What was it like as a
Oh
young boy?
no, that's just the reverse. I mean, if you might ask whether I actually chose my parents, because I couldn't have chosen better ones.
Oh, great.
No,
Yeah.
absolutely not. They not only not dogmatic. My father is a. I think he was hugely influenced by his own background, which was of some scholastic background, ancestral background. So he was always, he was a scholar through and through, but that doesn't answer your question, which is more in, more interesting, which is, it was dogmatic. I think, yes, he had a dogma, which was scientific truth. He believed in logic and he believed in evidence. I mean, yes, that was a, down the line, no question about it. He had no, I mean, he was irreligious on those counts. My mother was a practicing Hindu, but in a kind of what might say she was, she would, it's more almost like she inherited her role to have the small statue of a goddess, which she had been left by her mother-in-law, if you like, although she had never met her. It came down the generations, as it were. Of the goddess Lakshmi, who is the household goddess. Remember, this is a pantheistic, Hinduism is pantheistic. So she had that, and she would pray twice, you know. But what did it amount to? I've seen her. Her mind was in the kitchen, even when she was praying. So it was a ritual, nothing more. And no, there was nothing of that sort. My father used to laugh at religion, of course. As a good skeptic would, but he was not hostile to it, and he wouldn't go into a temple. My mother did, mm-hmm. and I would accompany her. When I grew older, when I came home, she would go to the temple the day after I arrived to give thanks and so forth, that I was safe. Okay, that too was a ritual. That's what you're supposed to do. I would always go with her because I felt that was right. I'm not religious in that sense, but also I've inherited my father's. I'm less skeptical of religion than he was. I go to the chapel in my college. If I worked all afternoon and I'm having dinner in college, I tend to go to chapel for evensong because it is most marvelous, you know, the sense of meditation, if you like. It's an assembly, and I like that very much. Mm. I can essentially shift out my, move away from my daily worries, and so. I think that's the same with my sister, although she probably being being somewhat older than I think she has a greater reverence for Hinduist religion, but she's not religious. She will not, but she will, you know, put the sari on her head if she enters the temple, as my mother would do. but as I say, I think it's more ritual,
yes, than
sense of deep belief.
You mentioned there your sister, and she was 5 years older than you. So did you look up to, and you say she's very clever.
Oh, she was fantastic. She was, yes. She, but she also was, she was very bright. I mean, she still is bright. She's now, she's 84, and I speak to her every week. She's a tremendous lady. But I was her little brother, so. And I looked up to her a lot, and she influenced me a great deal because, well, I should say, first of all, there's a difference. We didn't get raised together in some deep sense, although we are a very close family. My parents influenced me enormously. My sister influenced me enormously. But together as a quartet, we lived in my lifetime, as it were, for the first, 5 years together, when we were in Dhaka for 3 years, and then we moved for a year and a half, since 46, to until my father found a proper job, I mean, a professorship at the Benares Hindu University in what is now Varanasi, 1947, we lived together. But then 47, my sister went to boarding school in Shantiniketan, which is far away, 450 miles away in Bengal, Tagore School. the school that Tagore founded. And I think she was sent there, my parents sent her there, because I think they felt we were now going to be pretty much permanently outside Bengal. In those days, there were not that many jobs. So then my father didn't get a posting in, say, an offer from the University of Calcutta or a place like that, which would be a natural place for him since we are Bengalis. But this is, remember, the 40s. So we're not talking about a cosmopolitan society yet. So they became cosmopolitans, but that was forced upon them.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were in Benares, and I think they probably felt that it would be good for her to have Bengali culture or learn the language. So she was sent to boarding. So for 3 years she was there. Then four of us went to Washington, because mm-hmm. my father was asked by the government to be the division chief in the IMF, in the International Monetary Fund, division chief of South Asia, which was a, I guess, Indian posting, if you like. We were in there. And those were the only 3 years we were together. And we had a wonderful time. But then when you came back, I was sent to boarding. Why? Because my father worried that I'd learned English so well, it would be a pity if I lost it in the schools that at that time in Benares, they were all Hindi speaking.
And Partha, did your sister stayed in India her life, or did she move to England like you or another country?
No, she studied in India. She went to university in Benares eventually, but initially in Calcutta. But she got married very early. She was 21 when she married her husband, whom they met in Washington when he was at the IMF as well, as a young research economist, I guess. And so, of course, she then traveled a lot because he sort of rose in. But she influenced me a lot because she used to read literature. So these three, I'm talking about the 3 years together mm-hmm. in Washington. So she used to read, she would have been what, 13, 14 or so. So she had Dostoevsky and the whole, you know, the modern university library, I guess. I think it's called Modern University Library. I've forgotten, but it may not be quite the right thing, but there was a whole series. She used to read that. And of course, I can imagine I would sort of peek into these books to see. So I'll try and ape her by buying my own book. But there wouldn't be Dostoevsky, of course, but there would still be books.
Yes.
It's that kind of thing.
So you said you went to Washington, D.C., as you say, your father was employed by the IMF. And it was a time when the four of you were together. How did you find America? I mean, it's a different, very very different world, I imagine, from Dhaka or Varanasi.
Absolutely phenomenal. I mean, the U.S. is, even now when I arrive, as my wife and I did just 3 weeks ago, San Francisco Airport, I still feel a tingling of coming home. I loved America. The United States was at that time far ahead, I think, in schooling, the ethos of primary schooling, than elsewhere. It was much more relaxed. So I went to the neighborhood school. And yes, we had a very, very good time. I think the first time, when I think about it now, must have been very, very wonderful for my mother in some ways, because, you know, she was she was Dhaka and Benares, and that's it. And now suddenly, in her mid-30s, she's in a extraordinarily... You remember the gap between Washington and Benares? I mean, it's still pretty huge, goes without saying. But then it must have been immense. And that was the first time I think she felt also that she didn't have to worry about the purse that much.
Mm-hmm.
Although my father's obligations to his brother were continued, but that was peanuts by then, because this was an IMF salary we're talking about. So we used to go to the art galleries, you know, go to the theater. And not that there was much of a theater, but when there was, I remember the first time we went to the theater, I must have been, what, about 8 and a half, we went to see The Ladies Not for Burning.
Mm.
Which was a touring company, and I think, if I remember correctly, in fact, I know, John Gielgud, Richard Burton, Claire Bloom,
they're there. The tops.
Yes, absolutely. So yes, we had a very good time there. I was very happy. And in retrospect, of course, it was also the only time we all four were there because, I mean, as I say, I was then in boarding. And then, of course, from the age of 11, when we went back to India, my age, 11, that is, I went to boarding. And from then on, I never lived at home. Mm-hmm. So in some deep sense, it was those 3 years with my, and before that, of course, I was just alone at home with my parents before going to America.
And when you came back then, I know you, the first school I think you went to wasn't very enjoyable, but I think then you eventually went to a school founded by Krishnamurti.
That's right.
And I think you found that much more agreeable. I mean, what was that like? Was it, what made that school so enjoyable?
Well, it was an exceptional school. I mean, I can't imagine a better school. I've, you know, since coming to Cambridge, of course, I've visited schools and my contemporaries, you know, in those days, I mean, they went to some of the best schools in this country, Eton or Clifton or Harrow, but they didn't match up to mine. I'm absolutely convinced of that. What was fantastic about it? Well, it was socially conservative, but intellectually not so. So that's point number one. Point number two, it was effectively coeducational, as Krishnamurti wouldn't have it otherwise. So third thing is, it was astonishingly beautiful terrain. It's on a plateau overlooking two rivers, a smaller tributary coming into the Ganges, and at that corner junction is the school, which was a forest, and in the forest clearings are the buildings. There's a huge amount of green and foliage there, 400 acres of land. And the girls' dormitories were at one end and the others were elsewhere. But the fact is, we had common dealings, as it were. Twice a day, we would have a, what would you call it? It's not so much meditation, but it's not meditation, but you know, you all gathered and you sat on the floor. And there would be some Sanskritic, Brahminic scriptures written, or some songs, devotional songs, 15, 20 minutes. And there would be somebody would give a short talk. And I had exceptional teachers. And one reason they were, I think, exceptional is that they were, in the normal course of events, they wouldn't have probably taught at school. But they were followers of Krishnamurti. And he would, it was sort of a lot more paternalistic. He would sort of look at them and say, "Now you're going to teach in my school." And that's it. So I had some fabulous teachers let me put it this way. Okay, so let's say I'm 13 or so, and I'm in a taxi with the housemaster, because we're going to the railway station to get the tickets for the journey that all my school will be making. And he asked me to come and help him with that. Mm-hmm. So we're in the taxi. And the taxi is going, and then when it turns, we swerve our bodies. So I ask him why we do that. And then there was a tutorial, which lasted the rest of the journey, explaining to me Newton's laws.
Wow.
Okay, that's the kind of school it was. So you ask a question and you get a serious answer.
These teachers you had then could have easily been university teachers or could have done something else.
But
they had a sense of vocation then, obviously.
Yes.
And like when you were at that school, what sort of subjects, were they the same subjects you do in like Eton or Harrow? Were you doing conventional maths?
Oh, yes, absolutely. It was part of the Uttar Pradesh Matriculation Board, so it had to go through the whole hoops. So, of course, I had, the school was very conventional in the sense that it was conventional subjects. I had, we'd inherited the UK system of rather specialization at an early age. Mm-hmm. And so I had to choose at the age of 13, I had to choose it for my age 15 exam, which was the school leaving exam. Between geography and history, I couldn't do both. Because there were, you had to go through certain branches. So I had maths, of course. I had English. I had chemistry and physics. And biology, I think I did. I did those. And then there was just science, I guess, they'd call it.
Yes.
But I had to choose between geography and history, and I chose geography for a very good reason, but it was the wise decision. But anyway, that's what I did. So, yes, the teaching was, the syllabus was the same as anywhere else, at least in Uttar Pradesh. Yeah.
Intellectually, did you find school easy? Were you beginning to see then that maybe the intellectual life was the life for you, or were you a late developer, or were you always clever?
No, I don't know if I was clever. I don't know if I'm clever even now. But the, I'm not sure I ever said to myself, I'm going to be an academic. I used to play a lot of cricket. I was captain of the school team. I used to goof around a lot with my friends, goes without saying. I also had crushes because there were girls were around there, you know, just a few hundred yards away. Several crushes, actually. But it was quite a socially conservative society, so it's not as though you could mix with them easily.
Mm-hmm.
That wouldn't be encouraged, so to speak. I don't think I made a decision about academic life or anything like that. It didn't come like that, but I was taking studies very seriously. I enjoyed studies very much. I think the background, the paternal, the home background where my father was always working, or you know, and talking about his work and with the students coming in and so forth. That atmosphere was complemented by my school atmosphere.
Okay. Because one thing I've read about these years that, you know, when you left your secondary school and then went to the University of Delhi to study physics, I think you've said, well, it wasn't that I had a massive, you know, interest in physics from the age of five. And, you know, it was just that was the thing that you did if you were kind of intellectually ambitious, because it was the hardest. And was that the case? I mean, you just felt, well, I want to really stretch myself. And that's what people that want to stretch themselves study.
No, I think no, it wasn't stretching. Again, it was more the ethos where even my father, I think his sense was the grandest of subjects is physics. That sort of one of his people he knew from Dhaka, one of the great physicists of the 20th century, S.N. Bose, you know, Bose Einstein, statistics Bose. Well, I met him. He when he came to Benares, he would come and have lunch at our place, and I met him subsequently. So it was more the ethos that physics is the grandest of subjects. So if you're clever, isn't that what you want to do?
Okay.
That's I sort of moved into it without really any great thought.
And when you, okay, so when you got to the university, I mean, you say you got a great education at secondary in the Krishnamurti school.
Absolutely.
And I imagine the University of Delhi is extremely good as well. How did you find that experience, both socially and intellectually? How did it change you?
Well, I think I missed my school very much. So it took me some time to get used to the university campus, you know, with so many colleges and everything. So it wasn't a very happy time for me. I can't say I was very happy there. I was, you know, I'm not complaining, nor was I complaining then. But it was okay. It was fine. I did well. I was doing fine. I worked hard. But life, in some sense, didn't have the sort of zing that I had when I was in those 2 years in the Krishnamurti school. Because it gave me many things in addition to great teaching. It gave me a marvelous environment to walk along in, you know, in the evenings I used to go for strolls with my friends by the Ganges. Occasion, you know, even dipping into the Ganges for a swim, that sort of thing. Plus, of course, I had the privilege of meeting Krishnamurti, rather intimately, in fact, because he didn't know Hindi. He could only speak English, and my school was a Hindi-speaking school. It's no longer, by the way. It's become English-speaking. I mean, the medium of instruction is English. But at the time I was there, it was medium of instruction was Hindi, and I think the only student in school who knew English fluently. So when Krishnamurti came, both these years I was there, he was there for 1 month each, because he had a foundation there and he came to meditate and take time off from his lecturing duties and so forth. So occasionally he would ask, maybe 3-4 times each visit, to have his kid accompany him when he went for his walks along. And it's a magnificent terrain, because you have peacocks, you know. They're lovely to watch. Even their sound is, from a distance, is not bad, put it that way. We would go for walks, and he would occasionally talk, or make some, you know, observe something, make some observation. Now, it's not as though I became a fan of his or anything of that sort. He was beyond me, but I could see this was a pretty impressive figure, and that was a privilege too. So I missed that complex of, and the attention I had from my teachers was, of course, enormous. I think I had 4 years in Delhi, and it was good. It was fine, but nothing exceptional. I think in some ways I didn't develop much there. In a way, I developed those 2 years.
Okay, interesting. In fact, quite a few of my guests have said that their school days were much more intellectually fruitful than their third level, at least for a BA. It just all felt a bit disparate, and they didn't have that closeness that you have when you're in school, you know?
Yes, I guess that's probably right, yes.
Okay, so you do your 4 years in Delhi, you major in physics, as you say, and then you go to Cambridge.
Yes.
So can you tell us a little bit about the genesis of that decision?
I think, again, these things happen sort of organically. I think my father always used to tell, you know, at dinner table and everything, that Cambridge was the greatest place on earth, you know, for his, you know, his world of academia. And it's not just so much Keynes, but it was Marshall for him, who was the founder of modern economics, if you like, at least the economics that we all do now, at least at this side of the continent. Of the continent and the States. So I think he always thought that I should come here to Cambridge. And I didn't have a very determined life. I just did things as they came along. I didn't have a grand plan. And in fact, I used to worry about that later in life when I saw my friends, even in their research, they had a strategy of research, what they want to do next. I sort of moved from one topic to another, depending on what problem. I mean, later life, when I became a lecturer at the LSE and subsequent professor, I've never had a sort of I want to do this because it's my goal. I've never had that, and I didn't have it then either. So I came because it was a rather natural thing to do. I was being told all the time that this is a great place and you should go there. And my grades were good. So I came here. Mm. I got a scholarship. It was sort of a loan scholarship. It didn't really amount to a scholarship, but from the Tata Foundation. And came here and studied. For 3 years, I did maths. I did the PhD level, part three of the maths tripod, and then did my PhD.
Yes, and I mean, what's interesting is you went to one of the top colleges, so you know,
yes.
you're in St. John's, and you probably would have, or was it Trinity?
I was at Trinity.
You were in Trinity, sorry, doing your maths. So I imagine you met some very interesting mentors and fellow students. When you arrived, it's one of the top colleges, as far as I know, in Cambridge. Can you maybe say something about, you know, who you met and who you became friendly with?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked me this, because it's a give you a curious answer. Okay, so I'm coming from India, but one of my father's, not when I say one of my father's heroes, I was about to say, he always used to talk about Bertrand Russell. I mean, my father was a sort of more of a socialist than Russell would ever have dreamt of being. But my father, that is, he was a left of center mm-hmm. person. But he drew his intellectual, he could track his intellectual history back to sort of John Stuart Mill, that the enlightenment of this part of the world, okay? So Russell was somebody, and I read a lot of Russell when I was in college in India. And he had a number of autobiographical essays, as you probably know. Russell worked a lot on that. So I was convinced the way, and in those days, in Victorian England, of course, you took each other very seriously. That is to say, you know, and Russell would talk about Moore and say that the finest mind I ever met. And then I met, you know, Frank Ramsay, who is 30 years younger, and I've never seen such genius. So with that kind of a background, when I arrived, I really was petrified. I said, everybody's a genius around here, and I'll be shown off, and I wouldn't be able to cope. So for 1 week, I stayed in, I didn't go into hall because I, you know, was scared. Mm. I came just before time began. So and then I realized, of course, I had paid for my food meals. And that was compulsory. So I was losing money by eating sandwiches, if you see what I mean. But in great trepidation at the end of my first week in Cambridge, as it were, before term had begun, I went into hall. Now, this is Trinity. And of course, Trinity also has the highest, I mean, it's just phenomenally brilliant. No question about it. At that time, it was even more concentrated than it is now, in the sense that, you know, other colleges have siphoned off brains. But at that time, it was extraordinary. So I was sitting quietly at one corner of the table, you know, at the student's table, and minding my own business, pretending that I wasn't there. A young man came and sat opposite me. And he introduced himself. I didn't sort of vaguely heard that he was Francis. And we started chatting, and he became one of my closest friends. He was Francis Cripps, he's the grandson of the Stafford Cripps.
Wow.
And you know, that time. And about as brilliant a guy I've ever met. I mean, he exuded IQ. He'd gone to Eton. So that's how I got to understand their teaching and as we grew. Okay, so that was first. We became closest of friends. Then the first week of term, we had tutorials. We call them supervisions here, by the way. It's, you know, one to one or one to two teaching. Was with two future FRSs, okay. And but the person I was with, Chris Garrett, another absolutely brilliant guy, but a very different social class. He'd gone to Clifton, came from a middle class family, and his father was a major in the army. And then, you know, after the war, I think did just small time work business. And he became such a close friend. And now we see each other. We know each other well. I mean, we keep in touch with each other. And he was devastating, given that he's a mathematician. He's a very famous oceanographer. And he became a professor of oceanography in Canada. So then through him, I met Simon Blackburn. All this is in the first 2 weeks, by the way. Simon Blackburn is a great philosopher. He's a professor of philosophy here eventually. I mean, in fact, I had some things. I like to think that I helped him to come back to Cambridge as professor, by the way. I didn't, but I like to, I pretend that I we became. So I had, fortuitously, I just, by accident, I guess, my closest knit, you know, my network, closest network, were really brilliant and wonderful people. And we've kept together all these years, all these decades. So, yes, I had my social life in my local intellectual life was good. I enjoyed that. But there's no question I was very frightened here initially.
Mm. And I mean, did the transition to being comfortable in that milieu happen suddenly, or was it like, did you slowly get your confidence when you found, oh, I can manage with in this company, even though it's very impressive?
I think it had to do with the other parties. They took me seriously.
Mm.
I mean, that must have helped a lot. I don't think they cared, you know, the one way or the other. We were all young people in our late teens, remember? 18, 19, 20, that sort of age group. I never had any social problems here. Absolutely not at all. It was the problem I was mentioning is to do with, are they so clever that I'll be caught out?
Yes.
Nothing to do with, you know, can I eat my peas with my fork without spilling it? That was not a problem. Never.
And Partha, so they were your peers.
Sorry.
In terms of your professors
Yeah.
who both when you were doing maths and then when you moved to do your PhD in economics, who were the key influences there? Who did you find most impressive or helpful?
I think in the maths area, the person who influenced me quite a bit, and then we became very good friends after I came back here as professor, was Peter Swinnerton Dyer, very distinguished pure mathematician. He was dean of the college, and he lived a bachelor's life, and he got married later in his late 30s, but introspective sort of person, extremely brilliant. He was a great chess player also. I think he played chess for England, if I remember correctly. Anyway, but he was tutor. He was tutor, of course, and he was also dean of the college. And because he lived in college, I got to know him because there were about half a dozen of us in college who were foreigners. I mean, foreigner, from far away, and we couldn't go home in the vacation time. I mean, there's no way I could go home. First of all, there was not enough money, so I did stay here 3 years before I could get back home for one visit. So I would be kept in. I was lived in college. So of course, what happens? Long breaks, summer breaks, because you run into each other. And then he was very nice. He would invite us, a few of us, to drinks at his rooms and chat about things. He influenced me a lot because he was devastatingly clever. He was taciturn, he didn't speak very much, but if you asked him a question, he'd give you a very deep answer. He was a pure mathematician, but he knew physics very well. He knew the biological sciences very well. I mean, he was more of a complete thinker. I got a lot from him. And then, of course, when I moved to economics, or when I say when I moved to economics in large part because in my third year, as an undergraduate in part three, I was elected to what's known as the Apostles, it's a secret undergraduate society dating back to the middle of the 19th century. It's a very distinguished, no question about it. You're elected to it by your fellow students, but then it's all done very hush hush. The reason it's hush hush is they don't want to be lobbied for inclusion.
Okay.
That's all. And you can then declare you were one 10, 15 years down the road, because then you have no power for election. So you can't do it. That was the idea. And you, in the Victorian times, it was very significant because they discussed personal matters, psychological matters, for example. If you read Frank Ramsay's biography, the biography of Frank Ramsay that's recently been published, you will see how deeply they were involved in, the fact that we're not, there are forces at work, which we don't really understand, so forth. And these were subjects which are not exactly dinner table topics at Victorian England. So it was very progressive, if you like. And the whole lot of these guys were members of it. Russell, Wittgenstein, you named Moore, MacTaggart, Keynes, of course, Lytton Strachey. They were all late Victorian members of it. And I was elected to that. And I think Francis Cripps got me in it. And he was, of course, towering figure of my generation as an undergraduate. So he was there already a year previously. So he got me elected there, or recommended it, and then I was screened by the members. But one of them was Jim Merlis. I was a very distinct. He became a great economist. He was at that time a young assistant lecturer, I think, indeed. And from my interest, he said, "Why don't you do economics? I'll try and get you some money to shift over." So that's why I thought it was very interesting what he was talking about at the meetings, and I
Okay.
felt I could he influenced that he directed me in that direction. The other thing was I moved to economics because of the Vietnam War, in the sense that I was, like many of us, we were against it and so forth, so marches. But most mathematicians wouldn't know where Vietnam is, let alone what the worst. Whereas the social scientists, the few economists I knew, they had some thoughts about it. So these were two people who influenced me a good deal. But of course, I had other very good teachers, John Polkinghorne, who taught me maths a lot. And I think he would have influenced me a lot if I'd stayed on in physics. But then he himself left. He went to the church. He became a priest.
Yes.
You know, I mean, he's a very famous physicist, but he was quite influential in the sense that I liked his style of, a robust style of doing, trying to solve physical problems. These are some of the names.
Okay, very interesting. I mean, that group you mentioned, the apostles, as you say, it's notoriously secretive kind of society.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to press you on that. But
no, you can, because so many books have been written on it.
Okay. Well, one of the things that's always amazed me is not interested me, is like what happened. So you'd arrive at what the apostles would assemble somewhere in someone's rooms, I imagine.
Yeah.
What, you would talk about a topic or someone would present?
Yeah. That's right. The group, because you met weekly during term time. So we're looking at 8 meetings a term. That's and before, probably 20 in all, because the last 4 weeks of the final term are given over to exams and everything. So maybe, let's say 20 meetings. The week before the end of a meeting, somebody elects to be the speaker the next meeting. And the talk will be 15, 20 minutes. And you're expected to prepare notes for it. And then you give those notes over to what we call the ARC. The archives keep it, okay. And there's, you know, somebody's out there has access to the, it's in King's College somewhere. So the person gives the talk, and then the rest draw lots to give the sequence of comments. So with numbers 1 to 12, let's say, and then you're number 3. So then you have to go to the hearth. There's always a hearth. This is in somebody's room, so I'll tell you in a minute. It was actually at our time, initially, it was Morgan Forster, Ian Forster's room.
Oh, yeah. In King's,
yeah.
Yeah.
And he didn't come because he was by then retired. He was an angel. You know, after 3, 4, 5 years, you retire, you just take off. But that doesn't mean that you don't take interest in the thing. And so we used to meet there. And so you go to the hearth and then you make your comments for the 2-3 minutes or 4 minutes. And, you know, depending on how vigorous your comment is, you could have it. And the discussion goes on for about an hour or so, hour and a half, could be even longer. I mean, I think in the Victorian, Russell writes about where it could go on till midnight and it could get very heated when Wittgenstein in particular.
Yeah,
it would be very heated. Now, but the ethos or the topics of discussion were, in some sense, hugely mediated by the composition of the membership, and of course that would turn go have swings, because at my time there were 2 or 3 economists, 3 or 4 economists actually. So there was a tendency, you know, obviously you know somebody you can vouch for. So it's not surprising that you would have some historicists there, if you see what I mean. And there were a couple of philosophers. Quentin Skinner was a philosopher of political philosopher, political scientist, political historian of thought, if you like. John Donne, these are. So you had sort of a mixture of types there. And we discussed a lot on methodology, scientific methodology, whereas in the 50s, they discussed homosexuality, I guess. There was quite a number of the prominent, one or two of the, I think, gang of 4 who betrayed in England were apostles.
Mm-hmm.
One of them, not Philby, not sure if Philby was, but...
Burgess, was it?
Burgess, I think, was.
Yeah.
And the only other thing that's worth is that once a year you have a dinner, and that's when the angels show up.
Oh, okay.
They're invited. And the dinner has the dinner is organized by an angel. The finger points to the next in line, because you've got a book with the list of all the members, you see, so you work through. And so he, or in our case, it was always a he, we admitted women subsequently, of course, would issue the invitation to the dinner, and then let's say 40, 50 of us show up, then he would give the dinner talk, and usually about some serious theme that they used to discuss at that time, maybe, or how people feel about those issues today, that sort of thing. This was all very serious. The entire thing was always serious. although the attitude was not necessarily somber. It was, the issue was serious, but you could have a lot of fun. You could have, make jokes and so forth. And then the latest entrant to the apostles would be the secretary of that dinner.
Okay.
And he would give an account of the year's activities.
I mean, in that, it sounds like you kind of, it made you into a Renaissance man. You had to have a certain facility then to respond to topics that were maybe beyond your expertise.
I think there is that, yes. And that, in some sense, when we were young, I remember Simon Blackburn, who was elected, I think, at the same time as I was. We both were somewhat impatient with that, the point you've just now mentioned, because the aspect which we felt we were sound on, he and his and my, yeah, I felt the others were probably a bit superficial.
Mm.
And is that worth encouraging? Is that something? But all in all, I would say that was rubbish. The idea wasn't that you have experts talking to each other. The idea is for friends to explore ideas. And you might be talking rubbish. But then it would be lucky, you know, it would be surprising if there wasn't somebody who would point out, wouldn't point out that you were talking rubbish. And that's okay.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because I think when I look at your work, and we'll come to this later, because one of the things that I find very impressive about your work is your openness to other disciplines and your, not just your openness to, but I think your emphasis on the importance of incorporating the insights of other disciplines beyond, you know, a narrow focus on economics. And a lot of the time economics is narrowly pursued by economists. So we'll come to that later. I'm not sure if the apostles had an impact on that, but there does seem to be a kind of a continuity there. Well, anyway, so you as you say, you finished your mathematics kind of pre-PhD course, but then you moved into economics, and then you did your PhD on optimum economic growth, that kind of topic. Can you explain why you went into that and why you thought that was worth pursuing for someone that doesn't know anything about that? Do that. That's sure. A tall order, probably.
I can very well explain to somebody who doesn't know anything about it, because I chose it when I knew nothing about it myself.
So, okay.
So, you know, sounds nice to say, well, I moved to economics to do a PhD, but that's, you see, huge leap from maths to economics. So how did that happen? So I had to take 1 year's coursework called the Cambridge. It was innovative that way. It allowed you to do something called a diploma, which involved you doing some coursework. Say out of the 6 papers, you did only 3 of the part 2 papers, final year undergraduate papers. And then you wrote a little dissertation. And you get a diploma and then you're out.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I was enrolled to do. And so I did that 1 year under, again, my tutorial tutor was Jim Burleys. He was at Trinity too. In any case, he had invited me to. So he'd asked me to do, I mean, he encouraged me to do economics. So he was the natural person. So he tutored me or supervised me. And now I knew no economics. Absolutely none at all, although the son of an economist had the faintest idea what the subject was about, okay? But I need some maths. So what is it? I had 3 papers to take. One was statistics and econometrics. Well, that's all right. That's standard stuff. The other 2 were advanced economic theory and mathematical economics. So I took those 2. So that way I could do it without thinking that I'll fail.
Mm-hmm.
I did do macroeconomics and, you know, monetary policy and so on. None of that. I wouldn't know what to do with it. So I did these 2. Now, in that time, growth theory, long-term growth theory, had become very prominent in the subject. Very understandable. The economics profession was responding to, I think, something like a social, not need, but a social query. How do countries grow? New countries were coming up in the sense of being coming out of colonial status. Africa was emerging and India had already had 15 years or so of independence, or 20 years of independence. So long-term growth of economies was very much a fashion. And what's the best way of doing it, of course, was a natural question to ask. People call it optimum growth. And there was a sizable literature already within about 5 years. A huge amount of very, very good work was being done, had been done, and some of them being done by my own teacher, Jim Merlis, who then became one of the world's great mathematical economists, of course. So, but at that time, he was just very. So naturally, I wanted to get a niche there. And the fact is, the mathematics of it was pretty straightforward for me. So the answers I gave, the question in the two exams papers, they're all on optimum growth, believe it or not. Somehow or the other, I swung the answers to capture that in order to pass. Okay. So I came into economics in the end of my first year to start doing my PhD with no understanding of economics. And in some sense, my education in economics is very uneven. And I haven't really corrected it because I've just worked on problems and that. So I chose that subject because it was a one which I could handle. I think I understood it. But I did one thing, and that sort of finishes the question. Where's my response to your question? I did choose a problem which I felt was very interesting without knowing why at that time, I think, which nobody else had worked on, which was to not just ask how much should we save from our national income, which was the question which Frank Ramsey had initiated, by the way. I mean, it's interesting that there's the apostles followed me all the way through my PhD too, because it was Frank Ramsey's great paper which started the whole subject, but then was aborted because in the 30s, nobody was interested in long-term growth. They were only interested in short run, you know, demand management, you know, Keynes and so forth, and then the war. So it was only in the late 50s that Ramsey had been rediscovered by one or two mathematical economists. And Merlis had picked that up and written a very famous paper on that as well in the mid 60s. But they took population to be exogenously given. So you had a forecast of population, and then now you ask, given that, and then if you use a utilitarian calculus from now, you know, including future generations, how should you balance the needs of the future against your own needs? And so that balance was what was being analyzed. And Ramsey started it all off. And then, of course, you had huge different wrinkles to the models to make it more realistic, if you like, or pick up other kinds of issues like technological progress and so forth. Not just capital accumulation. I asked the question, what would happen if you choose population as well, not just population size, because you could affect future population by demographic measures or whatever. And then you would have a twin problem, because how much you save depends on how many people there are going to be in next period and the year after, and how many people are going to be in next period the year after or something that you are also deciding now, then that bounce back onto how much you save. So there were two forces at work. And that turned out to be non-trivial, conceptually. I'm still very proud of that paper. And I think it's one of my most well-known papers, not because people have worked on it. People avoid talking about population, as you know, but they recognize that it's recognized that that's a problem that we ought to be thinking about. And I had a first cut at it.
Very interesting. I mean, so that population, you kind of put population back in the center ground. Well, you endogenized it rather than...
Yes,
I mean, did you do that because you knew you could do it and then you found out the significance of that later? Or did you kind of know the significance of that even at the time?
I think I knew the significance of it at the time, but for a very reason which might... interest you. I know will interest you, but you might find intriguing. So we're looking at a utilitarian calculus. You're adding up utilities of people, okay, and then you're asking, you know, what activities will. Of course, the ethical foundation, the foundations of that kind of reasoning dates back to the 19th century at the latest, as it were, and the canonical work on that is the great work of Henry Sidgwick, Methods of ethics, I think it's called. I can't remember the name now. But that's where he gave utilitarianism its sort of, John Rawls calls it classical utilitarianism, its final shape. Mm-hmm. I read that book then. I read it out of curiosity, after I had finished the paper, by the way. I wanted to see how it fitted in with the school of thinking. And when I read that, I sort of realized that this was, if others hadn't done it, it was because they were silly. This is a hot, really interesting subject. Why is it interesting? Well, it's interesting because if the number of people is given and fixed, as it were, fixed in the sense you can't influence it, then all you need to ask is something better or is it worse? Hmm. And you can't say, are people happy or unhappy? It doesn't make any difference what you do. So if you ask, is it cold today? You can only do it with respect to what it may have been yesterday or tomorrow, or some benchmark you've decided ad hoc defines the difference between cold and hot. But say we have centigrade to measure temperature, we have Fahrenheit to measure temperature. You don't ask whether the only thing you can do with temperature is to say whether it's hotter or colder. And when we say today's hot, period, we have some arbitrary temperature in mind around which we are talking about hot or cold. Mm. But the science doesn't give it to you.
No. We interpret it that way.
You interpret it that way because of your sensations. So you could use another measure, which is sort of completely way off, and you'll still be asking them to work together. You'll be asking whether today's hotter or colder than yesterday. And you can say a few more things but not much more than that. Mm. But when it came to, and so that kind of reasoning went on in optimum growth theory because population was not amenable to influence. But if it is, then a very interesting question, important and crucial question crops up, and every potential parent thinks about it. If I have a child, is her life likely to be good or bad? Now that's the difference, because now what's the measure there? You would say, well, in the absence of being born, there is a natural zero there, if you like. Mm-hmm. And of course, I asked further questions like, it does mean to say, I'm glad I was born. What does that mean? That kind of question. But at the first level, you have a natural zero of utility. So it's like weight. Now you're coming. Zero weight has a meaning.
Yes.
It's nothing, if you see what I mean. Mm. Air, of course, air has weight, but you know what I mean. You don't have negative weight, but with utility, you can have negative unhappiness, misery. Or you could say, you have these questions that, we're tragic questions we have to face. Suppose I'm reliably informed by the medical profession that the child I will have all sorts of difficulties. I know in advance of that. Now, of course, after the child is born, you don't ask. You say, of course, we'll do the best we can for the child. But before, it's not insult to say, maybe I shouldn't have a child.
Mm. And you can use non-arbitrary criteria to help you make that decision.
That's right. It's a terrible decision to make, but the point I'm making is not that it's easy. It's just that introduces an issue which people face, but the standard method of thinking of utilitarian reasoning avoids doing because population, it's all either better or worse. Mm-hmm. Then you ask, how do you define better? After all, there are some people who are rich, who are somebody who are poor. Well, you have then a huge literature on inequality, poverty, you name it. But you do not ask the question of what is, and when you say it's poverty, you say this is so low that we really have to do things to improve it. But to say that they have negative utility doesn't mean anything.
Okay, very interesting. It was like a eureka moment after you had submitted it.
Yeah, or after it's published, actually. Yeah.
Well, you obviously finished your PhD, and then you did a number of you took up a number of temporary positions, obviously. Well, not obviously, but you did, and then eventually you got a full time job in LSE, which, as far as I can see, was a much more happening place for economics, from an economics point of view, than probably Cambridge was.
Oh yes, very much so.
Can you talk about that time and how that helped you develop as an economist?
Yeah, I think it worked greatly to my advantage. I should say, first of all, I didn't have any great, when I think of the many co-authors with whom I have written papers who are extremely smart, brilliant, and they all had sort of I can't think of any of them who have had a goal of what they wanted to do in the next 5 years, 10 years. I never had that. Now, the reason you mentioned that I fooled around for 3 years, my CV says, one year here, 1 year there, 1 year there. Now, that's a very commonplace experience amongst theoretical physicists, biologists, and so forth, because they get, 2 year postdoc here, 1 year postdoc there, and then finally get a tenurable position, as it were. That's very commonplace. It's not the commonplace amongst economists, or at least wasn't at my time. The reason I moved around a lot was that I couldn't get a job here in Cambridge. It was, they were very anti-math at the time. By the time I finished my PhD, they were very anti-mathematical. And they felt this was, when Jim Merlies left here, that was a sigh of relief. Oh. by the people who had taken control of the university. Whereas, of course, he then created a whole school in Oxford and became one of the great giants of modern public finance, if you like, public economics. So the first year I was on the, you might say, well, why didn't you apply somewhere else? Well, the reason is that one thing I should just mention, that I was in a hell of a hurry to do my PhD because I'd met my wife, who was at that time an undergraduate at the LSE. And she would have graduated in 1968. And so I thought my target year for my PhD is 68, otherwise we can't get married, I wouldn't be able to, so forth. So I think mine is still the quickest PhD in the history of the economics department. It was done in something like October to the following April, not the following April, the following April. So we're looking at about 17 months, 16 months.
Wow.
from start to finish to submission. Because only because I wanted a PhD out of the way so that I could get out. And while I was doing that, I was invited by Carnegie Mellon University's, the business school's dean was spending the year here. And he asked me whether I wanted to come and spend the year at Carnegie Mellon halfway through my final year. So I asked my future wife, what about going to the States for a year? And she said, yeah, that's great. That's fantastic. So we went there. And then I had a research fellowship here, which I took leave from. And so it was very natural to come back here for a year. While she did it, my wife did it, a teacher's training course, a year's training, if you wanted to be a school teacher, which she did become. And so we were here then for a year. And while here, I could see I wouldn't get a job here. And I was invited then by friends at the Delhi School of Economics to come and spend a year there. So I went there. Again, it wasn't the sort of, I wasn't worried about, where do I settle down and so forth. It sounded nice. Also, I had married an English girl, so I thought it would be good to spend a year. She could see what India is like. And, we used to toy with the idea that I'll settle down in India eventually together. That was how people did things in those days. This is, we're looking at over 50 years ago. So we went for a year there. And while we were there, I applied at LSE.
Oh, okay.
And I did get a job. But I should say, it wasn't the clear cut. It was Frank Kahn who ensured that I got the job. Because Frank Kahn was one of my teachers here. So that's...
He put a word in. He put a good word in for you to get the job in LSE, or was he was in LSE?
Oh, yes, very much so. He was professor at the LSE at that time. He had already moved there. And yes, very much so. He was... he thought I ought to come there. And yes, the answer to your question, that was a long-winded answer, but that was only because you said you were not quite settled for 3 years, and I thought I ought to explain why. That was terrific. I loved the LSE. It was very hugely brilliant professoriate, but very eclectic. So you had as mathematical economists like Hahn and Gorman on one end. These are towering figures. And then you had extremely illiterate, innumerate ones like Lord Bower, Peter Bower, who became a lord, and others. But they were equally distinguished. And the fact is, they didn't quarrel. And so when I arrived there, I couldn't believe it, that there was no rancor in the way I saw here. So I was well out of it. And I was rapidly promoted. I became reader within 3 years, and then 2 years later, 3 years later, I think, I became professor. I mean, they promoted me very. And again, there was no, as far as I can judge, certainly when I became professor, I could see it was a much more eclectic sort of place. Now, it's not as though I had people who were reading my work very carefully. My work was very different from what was going on, but I think they took it seriously, otherwise I'd hardly be promoted.
Mm-hmm.
In the way I was. And I had experts to advise me on matters that I was confused about very easily. So yes, I had a terrific time. Intellectually, it was a great place.
Yeah. Partha, you did sort of say, like, you didn't go into economics the traditional way, where you kind of done BA, you've done the foundational work, and you knew what macroeconomics was, micro. When you went into the LSC, did you try and address those gaps, or did you feel, no, I don't? You just carried on going your own path.
Yeah, I carried on my own path largely because I just didn't. I worked on problems. I chased problems as opposed to top themes or subjects.
Yes.
So yes, my gap remains. If you ask me about monetary policy, I'll give you an imbecilic answer.
Well, I will say one thing to you. Your introduction, a very short introduction to economics, suggests you do know the field quite well.
Well.
At least to a non-specialist, I felt you knew you were talking about in that book, which is an introduction to the subject. Anyway, one of the things I'd like to ask you about that period was the work you did with Jeffrey Heal on sustainability, because that becomes a very important, problem, if you like, really going right through your career. Maybe so, could you explain what that work was and why it was important?
Yes. So this is, we are looking at now, roughly speaking, 1973.
Yeah.
And I was already at the LSE, but I continued to live in Cambridge because my wife had a job in a school here. So I used to not commute. I spent 3 nights in London and the rest of the time here. Jeff Peel was a contemporary of mine here in the economics. I didn't know him before. We became graduate students, but he was an exact contemporary. And he was amazingly clever, and he was, I think, at that time a lecturer here. He got in a job before sort of the door shut against mathematical economics, is what I mean. So to his good luck and to Cambridge's good luck, he did have a job here for 2-3 years, and then he went off to Sussex as professor, as a very young professor. He was terrific, terrific young man. Anyway, we were talking one day at coffee, and at that time these books came out, Limits to Growth by Meadows and Meadows, I think, 1970. Then there was another book that came out called World Models by by an engineer called Forrester, Jay Forrester of MIT. And they were predicting doomsday, because we run out of this or we run out of that. These were exhaustible resources. Now, those books hit the big time. Absolutely, the newspapers were flooded with it. And it didn't help matters just at that moment that there was a oil scarcity, but not because we're running out of oil, but because the Saudis got together and became a cartel, OPEC cartel, and raised the price 4 times. And the general public, of course, didn't quite see the difference between that and exhaustibility, but then sort of, yes, this is very important so far. Now, the economics profession, of course, completely trashed the work of Forrester and Meadows, saying that there are no prices here. These are all engineering models. that there's no innovation, there is no substitution between one thing and another, and so forth. So all the things that make for economic adjustments, if you like, something becomes more scarce, so the prices rise, and then you economize, and you try and discover things, and so all that's missing. So it came to rapid fire. The trouble was that I didn't think that that criticism was valid, met the needs of the moment, because, okay, so they don't have prices, but then on the other hand, in my growth models, there's no resources either. So both sides are at fault. We ought to include prices, obviously, some sense of market performance and so forth, but we ought to get our models to reflect the fact that there are exhaustible resources, and they weren't, by the way. None of the models had that. So Jeff and I were talking along that lines, and he's a liberal sort of guy, so he said, yeah, we're quite right, Pastor, let's work on it. And so we started fooling around on the blackboard and so forth, and that gave rise to our first paper, which was to introduce an exhaustible resource, which we extract and feed into production, which in conjunction with produced capital like roads and buildings and machines and so forth and human labor, produce output. Conventional models did not have the resource input into it. It was just buildings and roads and machines and human labor and ingenuity, which enables you to produce goods. Then out of the output, you decide how much to consume and how much to save. When I say you, each household does it, but then you can aggregate and then come up with some story about how the economy is moving. Or as in the case of Ramsey, you are, suppose you're a socialist economy and you're actually, government can actually choose the aggregate, then what will happen? Okay, so that was the story. So our model was introduced that. And then the natural question is, what about substitution possibilities between what you're extracting and?
Mm-hmm.
And so we turned the attention of the discipline, if you like, to issues of substitutability as to whether and how much. And we had a pretty complete story on that in a paper. And then Jeff at that time was editor of the Review of Economic Studies, which was the prominent theory journal. And he encouraged submissions for a symposium on exhaustible resources. And Bob Solow, one of the giants of economics, was also working without our knowing it on the similar problem. So his model came out the same year as ours did, in the same symposium. And I think the fact that Solow had worked on it gave it a lot more prominence. But yes, that's how we started. And then we wrote a book. I mean, when I say we, Jeff and I wrote a book at the instance of request of Frank Hahn again. And it's a very, this is a, academic world is a very, it's like a family. There's a lot of interconnections.
Miscuous.
My teacher, it was Jeff's teacher, and he was a giant of modern mathematical economics. He was at that time, you know, right at the height of his power. Come back to Cambridge as professor and was trying to turn Cambridge around, unsuccessfully, I should say. he asked us to write a book for a series he was. And so we did that, and we took the subject. And yes, you're quite right. If we tried to define sustainability without using the term, because that term didn't occur to us, but that was what it was about.
Mm. And I mean, and that was the kind of very matsy side of that problem. And then as you get more into the 80s, then you look at the connections between sustainability and social norms or systems.
Yes.
Like you've done the maths bit, now you want to look at the institutional side of things.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about that in a way that would be, you know, understandable to a non-specialist, if you can?
Sure, absolutely. I'm very happy to do that, because you're quite right. That's exactly how it happened. So this book came out in 1979. It's also, times have changed. The book... we submitted the book to the publisher in 1976, I think.
Wow, 60 years.
Exactly. So we had a Dickensian editor. I mean, he was straight out of Charles Dickens. He settled down in my study with the pipe. And the, so okay. So the whole thing went off to Hong Kong for proofreading, but slow boat, by the way, by the Mayflower, probably. About 6 months later came the galley proofs, you know. And so they made the what used to be what should have been footnotes into endnotes. And I said, nothing doing, got to have the footnotes. Endnotes, nobody likes reading, you know, turning the end of the chapter. So okay. So that took another 8 months because it had to be sent back to Hong Kong. Then came the page proofs. Anyway, it came out at the end of 1979. Meanwhile, what had happened was in 1978, I think, by chance, I came across a book by Paul Ehrlich and Anne Ehrlich and John Holdren. These are famous names. John Holdren was became one of the great science policy men. He still is. I mean, he's very active. He was Obama's chief scientific advisor. And he's just coming. And Paul Ehrlich is, of course, a giant of ecology and evolutionary biology. Anyway, they had wrote a book called Ecoscience. Now, remember, I was at the LSE. And by then, I'd become professor. But the LSE is a social science university. So there's no biological science, no physical science. So the bookshop, for example, which is where you hang around to sort of browse to see what's going on, would give you nothing about ecology or any of that stuff. I didn't know the word ecology even in 1970. But I came across this book, Ecoscience, just by accident. I used to subscribe to Scientific American. And so the publisher of Scientific American published that book. So they had an advert, so I bought it. And that was a revelation. That book I worked through chapter by chapter. And I found that what the world out there is not really about exhaustible resources, it's about renewable resources. Mm. Of course, there are exhaustible resources, you know, oil, natural gas, and so forth. That's for sure. So I was not going to debunk what Jeff and I had achieved. But the action in I thought this spirit of our life in the biosphere, of the human economy, is tapping into all that stuff that Mother Nature is supplying us with. And she will continue supplying it so long as we don't tarnish her beyond repair. So like a fishery or a forest, that sort of thing. And I found that coming through loud and clear in that book, although of course it is a very non-technical book. So what I did was to convert each chapter into a mathematical model. And I found, and of course I had no reason to believe that my modeling was correct, by the way. I'm now trying to model a subject which I don't know anything about. I'm not a biologist. But it turns out it was very fortuitous. You don't really need to know too much biology if you trust what they're saying, what the author is saying, okay? What they were talking about was the recurrence, the regenerative nature of watersheds or forests or wetlands or whatever, okay? And so every time I modeled it, I found it was the same model, mathematically. So the parameters are different, of course, and so forth. And that got me I felt this was very exciting. And I also, I think, by chance, read an anthropological work. I can't remember now whose or why I read it even. And it gave me an understanding of how poor people live in Asia, in this case, South Asia, and on the land and the waters, you know, water sources and their day-to-day life. And I got very interested in day-to-day life. I wanted to move away from long-term economic thinking, which is what I'd been doing, to what does a family do, household do, and how does it interact with other households? So in a sense, that reading led me to a completely new route of economic research for myself, that is. During that period, I'd been asked to write, thought I'd write a little book on that. So I wrote a book in 1982, which, by the way, completely bombed. Nobody has read it, or very few people have read it. It's called The Control of Resources, and Harvard University Press published it. But before that, it was published initially by Blackwell. And Blackwell had a very, very imaginative economics editor called René Olivieri. He's now a major figure, I think. He works for, he's head of one of the major NGOs now. Anyway, this is a long time ago. So he encouraged me to do the book, and then had a deal with Harvard to produce it. I'm very proud of that book because it's very imperfect, obviously, goes without saying, because I was groping, completely groping. But each chapter was on a different class of environmental problems. And I think the one insight I had in that book, which has helped me a lot, was to regard pollution as the inverse of conservation. Because pollution is something which is degrading a regenerative resource, like, say, the air, atmosphere, into which you're dumping carbon now. And that reduces the effectiveness of the atmosphere to be able to recycle carbon, into the biosphere to recycle carbon if you're doing too much of it. So that meant the two different disciplines could be integrated. You didn't have to talk about pollution and then say, well, I don't work on environmental pollution. I work on environmental conservation. You're basically talking the same thing. So that book had that. And in a sense, the review I've just recently done for the government is the culmination of the work that started there. So yes, even though the book bombed, we read the book, I'm still very proud of it. That's how I got into these issues that you just now asked. Yeah,
very interesting. And I mean, I'm very prescient that you kind of, I mean, what you started seeing then has now kind of entered the mainstream in terms of preoccupation of the world we're living in. I mean, one of the things I think that's very interesting, I think, you know, viewers might be interested in this, because this kind of what you just said there led you into it, is, you know, you start talking there about poverty. And there is this sort of conventional wisdom that, you know, if you want to try and reduce or even try and even eliminate poverty, it's not going to be good for the environment.
Yeah.
That they are mutually opposing.
Exactly.
And your approach kind of broke that logic a bit.
Absolutely. I mean, it's a terribly bad logic, because it's built on a faulty model. And the faulty model lies in the idea that the only way to get out of poverty is to work with a model in which there is no nature in it. So all the stories are going to be, if Africa, we don't want Africa, they have to develop. And what does that mean? They have to export more primary product, because that's all they've got. And so then they use that export revenue to invest in buildings, you know, roads and so forth, and such, in manufacturing. And then they try and become like the West, okay, and then join the international trade regime and so forth, okay. So that's an extremely, I mean, it's borders on criminality, criminal negligence on academics. And I'm an academic, so I'm talking about us, myself, you know, our group. Because every time primary products are tapped in Africa, it hurts biodiversity there, and their own populations are suffer. But they don't notice that, and that's not part of the price they pay, that they charge for the export. So this policy that the WTO and others have been selling, and the World Bank has been selling through and through, is one in which they're, without knowing, transferring wealth to the rich countries, because they're selling them too cheap. That's because natural capital doesn't enter. So it's as though you could export primary products without tarnishing your productivity of the human economy in, say, Nigeria or Malawi or wherever. So it's a very bad way of thinking. It's an extremely dangerous way of thinking. And of course, people suffer. If you read the writings of anthropologists in coastal village, fishing villages in Latin America, Africa, South Asia, or in the wetlands, you will find that they get hurt in a way which that hurt doesn't enter into the national statistics, because, of course, the depreciation of their capital doesn't enter into national accounts. So when you see distress migration, and then the Economist newspaper says it's because of bad governance there, that's just it's a way of saying we don't know what the answer is. You know, there's distress migration is because their capital assets have sunk. They can't grow food. Their animals, their cattle are dying, or their goats are dying, and so forth. You know, skinny as hell. You see that on TV. So what the newspaper, the journalists and BBC and others are showing us, it goes absolutely orthogonal to the economic model, because their capital base has sunk, and that's why they want to move. But when they move, they can't move because they're not allowed to move because their neighbors are capital. And so there's a conflict. And then you say, well, you know, you've got bad governance out there because they're killing each other. But of course, many of these sources have to do with collapse of the infrastructure, natural infrastructure, not roads, but water sources, sources of timber, medicine, food, that sort of thing. So grazing land and so forth. So yes, I quite agree with you. I think traditional model, you know, conventional models of economic growth are deeply, deeply flawed. And
I mean, when you articulate it the way you just articulated it, I mean, this is not a complex thing to understand.
Absolutely.
Once you've understood it. And so then you have to work. So why aren't we changing the model and stop looking at, you know, a market society which looks at GDP as the be all and end all? And that's a model that doesn't value nature or try and put a value on nature. In fact, nature doesn't even enter the equation.
Yeah.
But as you sort of said, but that's as insane as a company that owns a factory not valuing its factory and its machinery. No responsible business does that. And yet in the world of market economies, we exclude nature as a valuable asset that has to be protected. So for me, I imagine for most people that get to see that, say, okay, so why aren't we changing the model? We have to believe, therefore, that there's other powers that are excluding this. They know that model is limited, the overwhelming model, but they want to go along with it. So it looks like there's something else going on. There's an ideology going on that is excluding these very important factors, which are becoming more and more important when we look at the degradation of the planet. So it's not like, you know, it would be nice if we included it, but it doesn't really matter. When you look at the way the planet is going with these renewable resources that are getting more and more beyond the point of return, and yet what you're saying there still hasn't really entered the mainstream. Well, I'd like your view on that, actually. Is it beginning? Are you beginning to become optimistic that it's going to the mainstream, or do you still see the GDP model dominating and will continue to dominate unless we really hit a cataclysmic event that's going to force people almost to see the light and change?
Wow, that's a really hard one, but I'm so glad you were asking me this, of course, because it's something obviously I live with for some time. First of all, I think we should remind ourselves that it's not only the market economies that are at fault. The Soviet Union was as guilty of it. The modern conception of an economy, never mind whether we leave it to market forces or whether it's state planning or whether it's state capitalism or whatever, none of these places had nature in their model. Stalin didn't have, rather vociferously didn't have, I would imagine. But certainly the Soviet models that I know of, and I did, because in the 60s there were still remnants of the Soviet models. There was nothing on nature. Feldman's famous two-sector model, which was part of my PhD thesis, was that there's no nature in there. Okay, so it's not so much market as much as the fault here is not on market economies. It's just generally economics as it has grown in the 20th century. Now, why it has happened that way, I do not know. I would love to be able to answer you, give you a good answer to it. I can't even give you a bad answer to it. I just don't know the history of economic thought well enough. What the drivers are. What I do know is, of course, that progress in any subject is very path dependent. You build on your teacher's model, last one, or the last paper you read, you felt there was something wrong with it, so you tinker with it and you move. And so the direction in which you go is always improving on defects on the normal course of events, if you like, on the normal modeling. So making a departure is much harder for any. So, but I, having said that, I can't go any further because I really would be stretched to answer why there was such wide. How come what I'm saying is so orthogonal to what is in the mainstream journals and so forth regarding economic prospects? You put your finger on absolutely the right thing. You said GDP, and then you say, well, no firms have balance sheets, which is what you're saying, and you're absolutely right. So it suggests that economies, national accounts ought to be concerned with their wealth. And so, you know, you're really in some ways back to Adam Smith, the wealth of nations. We should be thinking about the wealth of nations, not the income of nations or the GDP of nations. Now, the GDP has a singularly bad feature, which the only way I can get an economist to, you know, any sort of mainstream economist who still feels maybe there is just a wrinkle of a difference if you include nature in it, is my reviewers suggest that it's not a wrinkle, it's a wholesale alteration in the way we conceive our economic prospects, and from the household side, right to measurement issues, right to economic possibilities and so forth. That's why it's a 600-page review that I did, okay? So that's for sure. The way to convince him is like this way. Suppose you have a chain of supermarkets which are very, very bad at monitoring customers. The pilfering is very easy, okay? For some reason, they don't have a good detecting system. Well, the householders who are purchasing from there, of course, are feeling quite rich because they don't pay for what they're consuming. They go there, take, let's say 10% they pay for, but 90% they've stolen. Nobody says anything. Well, then what's going to happen here? Well, they'll go bankrupt. So if somebody points out that this is what's happening and they'll go bankrupt, then of course the householders will agree, yes, something ought to be done. We ought to pay for our. But if they pay for it, they will not be as well off as before. Because the food costs a lot more. It's that we ought to be now getting our head around. That is to say, we've been pilfering from Mother Nature. We're not paying for the stuff she's producing because there's nobody to pay. She doesn't collect at the checkout counter, okay? So we have to create a checkout counter, societal checkout counter. And that's what my all my work from the 80s that you point out is concerned with, okay? So you want to do that. But if you do that, if you price all these things somehow or the other, then you're not going to be as rich as you thought you were. But that's because you're richer than you should be, because you're basically tarnishing your next generation, your children's 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 children. So again, we're back to the problem I started with in my life, which was intergenerational equity, fairness and sustainability. That's lots of issues. They come back now to it in a disguised fashion. But at the end of the day, that's what we're talking about. Mm. If we pay for what we consume, our activities, then we will be poorer on an income basis than we are today. But if we refuse to do that, we are essentially jeopardizing our great-grandchildren. And we have to come to terms with that. And so the pilfering story I just now mentioned is a way of recognizing that there's something immoral we are doing. We wouldn't think that pilfering is reasonable conduct or stealing from, you know, the supermarket. We put people to jail or at least give them a fine and so forth, okay? But that's what we are doing with Mother Nature.
Yes. So. Analogy you use with the stores that are easily robbed. I mean, and you say, for example, use the Amazon rainforest as that store.
Exactly.
And
that's exactly right.
That's very interesting. You mentioned the report. We didn't really introduce that properly. So this is the report that the UK Treasury commissioned on the economics of biodiversity, I assume you're talking about here.
That's right.
Which is otherwise known as the Dasgupta report now, I believe. Can you just say a little bit more about that? Because you've only kind of touched on that a little bit. I mean, it'd be nice to get a greater sense of the scope of that report and what's going to happen with that report.
Yes, of course. I think I'll be able to, in answering this, I'll be able to also respond to your previous question, because I didn't get around to responding to your question as to what I thought, whether things are changing or whether the business remains usual, whether we're moving to a system of accounts away from GDP, which is a flow. It's income, but it's gross income, not net income. Is the lack of it being net is with the real weakness, because the reason I mentioned just now, because it doesn't account for depreciation of capital. So you could tarnish the Amazon rainforest and GDP would still look, could be even better, because you're using that to bolster your output. Okay, so even as this asset dives down, your income goes up. Gross income goes up. So the whole thing is a scandal. I mean, there's no ifs and buts about it. This is first year undergraduate economics, by the way. I mean, anybody, you don't have to be an economist even. You know, sort of household can figure it out, that you're eating into your bank balance. Then in due course, you won't have a bank balance and you'll have, you know, where is the income coming from? So that's sure. So you were kind enough to suggest that sometime in the early 80s, my attention shifted, my interest shifted more towards sort of anthropological studies. And I'm rather sort of prejudice on my part. I don't say sociology, because I think sociologists have got themselves a bad name for doing bad sociology. Whereas anthropologists, at least the kind that I read, have a sort of a long background. You know, it's anthropology in some sense, if you remember, is a colonial subject. So, you know, the Brits went to India or Africa and then they saw a different culture and they wanted to understand it. So, I'm looking at now all the good things that happened, which are now ignored completely about colonialism. Because of the post-colonial mentalities, of course, everything was bad. Okay. Came in there and, you know, you did this, you did that. But the fact is, of course, huge amount of good stuff came out, you know, in terms of trying to understand. So that's a very serious discipline. Moved in that direction because I wanted to understand how non-market economies cope. And the only alternative was Soviet Union, but that's so boring that there's nothing to discuss, you know, command and control and so forth, and your rifles, you know, telling you what the hell, that's not interesting. What's interesting is small communities. There's a, you know, in Belize, you go there and you see fishing villages, or I went to Zanzibar and you have fishing villages, which sort of twice a day, men come out with spears and then take the fish home and then go to the market. There may be two fish there. They're not interested in selling the damn thing. They have enough to eat. Now, that doesn't suggest that it's a great way of life. I'm not suggesting that at all, but you need to understand that they're also operating in an economy. That's an economy. And they're worried about their capital asset, which is the coast, which they've inherited. So they have norms of behavior and so forth because they don't have a legal system. So all that required me to understand, try and understand. And what I'm now saying is outcome of reflection and trying to understand that norms really are alternative to laws and so forth. Okay, so I moved in that direction in the 80s, and in the 90s, I really hit the stride on trying to understand the idea of social capital, largely accidentally through the World Bank. I had a good friend who was a vice president, and Ishmael Sarageldi, very famous man. He became director of president of the revived Alexandria Library. In Alexandria, a man of great culture. Anyway, he was vice president of the World Bank and an Egyptian aristocratic. So he wanted to have a think tank to advise us. So he invited people like myself, Robert Putnam, Canaro, and a whole bunch of other people, artistic people as well. Yunus, Muhammad Yunus was one, and there was some artists and dancers, if I remember correctly, we would meet twice a year to think about problems the World Bank ought to be thinking about but isn't. And this was in the 90s. And one of them was, of course, social capital. So I found that with Putnam's help, I understood, I took that very seriously. And so that worked out very well. So I began to understand something, or at least I thought I was understanding. Okay, everything I say is about my perception of what I think I know. It doesn't mean it's right or anything. It's about, so the idea was to try and embed the human economy, the macroeconomy, to these alternative communities, which some of which are marketed, market-based, some which are not. And then there's a blend of that is what we see in the world around us, everywhere, including England and so forth. There's a lot of non-market economy here as well, by the way. Forget. Okay, so that worked well. And gradually, then I went back to macroeconomic modeling, long-term modeling. And with my friend Carl-Johan Mähler, we published a paper in 2000, which essentially laid the groundwork for wealth accounting. Because I was convinced that Brundtland was right in thinking, you know, the Brundtland report was right in thinking of sustainable development as something you should be thinking in terms of what assets you pass on to the next generation. Now, she, of course, the report had nothing to say about wealth or anything. I'm not even sure they talked about assets, but basically saying they should inherit whatever, at least as much as we had inherited. But that doesn't mean anything, because there's so many things that you can inherit. So mm-hmm. How do you aggregate this? And we pretty much quickly proved that it was wealth which ought to be. So that was the basis of the wealth accounting literature that came out. That has taken a positive turn. There are a number of people who are involved in it now. The ONS, Office of National Statistics in this country, is moving in that direction. Canadian government is, New Zealand one. China is. So we are moving away from GDP as the only way of thinking to additional measures which will involve stocks. So at the crudest level, you'll say, you know, what are your wetlands like this year as opposed to last year? What's their health status? And so the idea would be to invite ecologists to help. They should be involved in ONS work, not just statisticians and economists, because it should be anthropologists and ecologists as well, amongst other things. Okay, so that's going well, I think. It's so obviously necessary. And the economics is completely kosher here. There's no, you can't even say, what about the order of magnitude, or, you know, is this a first order problem or is it a second order problem? I mean, you can't go into that now anymore. It's so clear, especially with climate change, where GDP might be growing, but meanwhile you're absolutely, you know, completely rubbishing the climate system, and that's going to come and reverberate in the future on you. So that's part is very positive, I think. What is not positive is, I think, the needed recognition that we will have to give up things. The rich will have to give up things in the sense of having to pay. Hence my pilfering example. If you wanted to take sustainability seriously. Otherwise, it's just a word you use at international meetings and so forth. And in a way, the economics of climate change has helped that prejudice, because it's been so fashioned that and it has identified climate as a separate system, climate system, from the rest of the Earth system. Mm-hmm. Then they could say, we're doing it for management problem. It's too difficult otherwise. Okay, that's fine. That's a perfectly understandable approximation. But the point is that it does drive you in a different direction, because it says, let's try to get clean energy. If we get clean energy, then we'll be fine. You know, it was non-fossil fuel. Okay. Well, that's a technological problem. So how fast, you know, so social cost of carbon, what investment is required to move. So it becomes a technological problem. And then we say to ourselves, aha, we now solved it in a nice economic way. We can do cost benefit analysis to know how fast we should move to clean energy and how much you can spend on, you know, renewables or, you know, solar or whatever. Okay. And where is the kind of things you and I've been discussing the last hour or so is about things which are really not. Technology, of course, is always there, but it's institutional changes which are really required, huge, and also perceptual changes which enable us to accept the fact that we'll have to pay. If we pay, then we're going to be poorer. Mm-hmm. Because we'll think we are poorer, but if we're not, if we care about our children, our grandchildren, then if we add them, then we are not poorer. because they're getting richer, or they're not going to get impoverished if we husband our resources. So it depends on your scope. If you think of your dynasty, the story is very different from what you think about yourself, as though you're an instant person and die, and then that's the end of it. Okay. So how did the review come about? Because I was asked in April 2019 by the then Chancellor of the Exchequer, Philip Hammond, to lead a report, to produce an independent global review of the economics of biodiversity. And now, in a way, it's really surprising because it's the Treasury. Mm. It's not the Ministry of Environment. They had commissioned the Stern Review, which came out 13 years ago or so, on the economics of climate change. So they asked me to do this one on biodiversity. So I agreed immediately because I felt this was what I was working up to in a way. And I'm very glad I did. It's an independent review, so I can do pretty much anything I wanted. I, of course, I had an advisory board of the great and good, so to speak. You see what I mean? And they were very helpful. They were very supportive. Some were extremely supportive. And I was given a team. And I don't know how these things work. I never bothered to find out. But I'm absolutely charmed by the way the Treasury worked on this. The person who led the team, I had nothing to do with it. She informed me that she was going to be the leader of my team. I mean, she turned out to be fantastic. She hired 14 or 15 people. How and she chose people, why she chose them, I have no idea, because it never even occurred to me to ask her. It's not my expertise, field of expertise. But they were astonishingly exciting young group, very skeptical. Some of them were very skeptical of the economists, of what I was doing. But that was good, because they were very young. You know, I could go to the blackboard and show them. And then they got excited. And it was halfway through, they were pulling ore as fast as you can. I mean, they would anticipate my needs. Obviously, I had to shape the whole thing, but they made suggestions also. And they would say, oh, by the way, you know, we haven't discussed the OECD's measures of human well-being. Don't you think we ought to have an annex on that? So I said, sure, then you do it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was just a very, very exciting way of working. And yes, you're right. You were hinting at the idea that this was probably not so much a review for the Treasury. I was really addressing the citizen. Mm. Because in my mind, that this is such a delicate issue. The changes that we need to make can only come if we citizens insist on it. I'm afraid the citizen can't say it's a technical problem. How am I to think about it? That's why we hire experts. You know, we have, you know, that's for sure. The citizen is not going to say what. But on the other hand, the citizen has a intuitive grasp of it because she lives in the world. And she, if you're rich, you worry about lack of insects in your garden. And then you have a garden and you worry about lack of pollinators, and that worries you. Or the frogs haven't come. And then you record that and you then see, well, my gosh, yes, this review does say this is related to something else, this positivity. And that some other citizen, say in the Amazon, it's not lack of insects in the garden, but it's the fact that they're going to be evicted 5 minutes later from their home so that a mining company can start digging out there. And that may be their spiritual home, even. So that's a different kind of resource. I mean, that's an environmental problem. And then somebody else, you know, different people have a different experience of an environment, what I would call an ecological problem. Mm. All right. But each of them is relevant. Some are more important than others, that's for sure. You know, that I can't, you know, the beach where I go for my luxury swimming is polluted, is bad for me. To me, it's less of an important problem than being kicked out of your home in the middle of the Amazon. And then your tribe gets shot and so forth. But still, the fact is, we are looking at a problem of a community coming to terms with the failure, the breakdown of the local ecosystem. And what my review does is to pull them together into a unified way of thinking. That's what it does. That's the whole idea. It's a grammar. And from then follows policies, of course, goes without saying. And I do have quite a lot on that. My wife knew there was danger of my, at the back of my mind, I would have graduate students, so that the review would be very technical. And it is technical. The full review is 600 pages plus, and it has annexes and boxes and so forth, but it's quite a lot of maths. But if I didn't do that, I would be doing disservice, because these are quantitative issues. All these are quantitative issues. Ecology is a quantitative subject. The health of an ecosystem, the biodiversity, the measure of biodiversity. So it is technical. So she encouraged me to take 2 months off at the end of the writing period when I finished the review, take 2 months off and write a short briefer, which I have. It came out simultaneously, a 100-page document, which doesn't have any maths in it. That's directly addressing the citizen. And I hope she reads it, the citizen, that is. But the judge, the big one, is, I don't think at my age I would be accused of being pretentious and thinking that what I've tried to do is to restructure growth and development economics and the economics of poverty. And the motivation for the restructuring is what we've been discussing this past nearly 2 hours. Mm. It needed doing. And it's not simply getting a macroeconomic model to include nature. It has implications for how we think of the household economy, how we think of people who graze animals in a grazing land, and how we think of a fishing village. And these are all need to be seen through the same prism, because they are interrelated. So you can't say, well, that's a different problem, I'm going to look at this differently. Well, I'll have a different grammar for this and different grammar for that, because then you'll have mess, because they're not different. No. They happen to be different because the ecology is different. But the person who is born in a fishing village, in principle, could have been born in a grazing field. And then they would have inherited several knots and so forth. So the book is really putting that all together into one. And as you rightly pointed out, it started much earlier. It's taken 40 years or so.
Yeah, I mean, in a lot of ways, it's the culmination of a career, really, when you look at that report. And one of the things that, because I did read the 100 page.
Yeah, sure.
Which, and as you say, it's very understandable to a non-specialist, which is great. So congratulations on that. But one of the things that really has struck me is when I finished reading that report, and then also looking at your career is, you're a child of the Enlightenment, and the Enlightenment has a lot of people now go into bashing the Enlightenment project as skeptics do, and that it promised more than it delivered, and it was too scientistic and all that. And yet there is something really important here that, the Enlightenment said that knowledge is important and it should be democratized and disseminated to everybody. And in principle, everyone should have access to this knowledge, and in principle, everyone should be able to understand it. And when I finished reading, as you say, your synopsis of that report, the next big question I had is, I think it was Socrates said that knowledge is virtue. And we stop believing that. We say, yeah, you could be knowledgeable, but you can suffer from weakness of will, and you won't implement what you know. And yet that seems to be the dilemma we now face. Absence of knowledge is not really the problem we seem to face. It's we know, or we're increasingly seeing, you can't deny it anymore, where we're going. And yet we have this problem about changing. And I think that's going to be the big challenge. So maybe you say, I've done my work. I've done all I can do as an academic. It's now up to, as you say, these policymakers. And that's where my biggest worry is. Do we have the right people in the right positions to help us change in the ways we really need to change very radically to do the things we need to do based on reports like yours? and become less selfish and take a longer term view that looks beyond tomorrow. And that's such a massive ask that it can make you gloomily pessimistic and demotivated, because you just say, I just look out at the world and we're not doing any of this stuff. I mean, do you have a view on that?
Well, it's very good of you, very kind of you to say, and I mean this very seriously, that I'm a child of the Enlightenment. I like to think I am, very consciously. When I think of that, I think of my father and his father. Well, he wasn't quite an enlightened man, I still think. My grandfather was a Victorian guy, after all. But yes, absolutely. I'm very much a child of the environment, of the Enlightenment, and I've written it in that style as well. It's always addressing the citizen. Because in a democratic society, I just cannot think that we should think that it's the policymakers who are necessarily at fault. Because if it's a democratic society, we are ultimately responsible for the politicians we elect and hold them to account. So that's one reason my review was directed at the citizen. In fact, in the preface, I make it clear, even on the 600-page one, by the way. And my thought was that there, the citizen is not going to read it, but I had in mind an elderly lady of 70 or 75 or something, and she's worried about what the world her grandchildren are inheriting. And she wants to do about something. But she'll probably have a grandson, if not a grandson, maybe some nephew who can read the 600-page one. And she will say, go and read that and tell me. And I'll read the 100-page one so you can translate the technical stuff to me and so forth. So I know the whole thing is you don't really believe it. But if you don't have something like that as a possibility, then you may as well throw in the towel. Mm. So I wrote it for the citizen, because in democratic society, no, I mean, obviously I'm not writing for Russia or anything like that, because, I mean, they're beyond the pale. Mm. But I'm writing for essentially decent polities. And there are quite a lot of them. We have them in Europe, we have North America, we have India. And, you know, where you can actually... I mean, India probably a bit less now, but never mind. It's over the long haul, we're looking at societies where citizens can get together. And if they don't, it's their fault. It's our fault. Do I have any hopes on that? At the level of the review, the Treasury has been remarkably good. They not only published it, obviously, without any, you know, sweat, but they kept my team on for another 11 months for dissemination purposes. And I've had about 300 plus events, lectures, Q&As, interviews, panel discussions, and so forth. Fortunately, all on Zoom because of the COVID, which has been a great boon for me, for the review, that is, for anybody else. But they've been very, very, and then they produced a response, which is also on their website, so you can read that as well. And it's very positive all through. It's a 20-page thing. It was very positive. I think one reason it's positive is that I didn't say you should do this by this time and then next one to be, you know, in 2 years' time, 4 years' time, and so forth. Because I don't have the facility to be able to do that. I don't know what the timing is. I know it's urgent, but that's all I can say. Mm. Now, so that may have helped the Treasury in accepting it. So they can be committed to it without actually having to do very much necessarily. But on the other hand, in a democratic society, they can be held to account. I mean, my wife was pointing out the other day that one of the things that happened with my review is that there, up until my review, policies, they would all have a qualifier that and climate change ought to be taken into account or some such wording, and in all departments of government. Now they've added biodiversity. And she was right. She was saying at a dinner party, she was saying, well, you know, it may not happen, but there could be somebody who can raise their hand saying, but by the way, where is biodiversity in this reasoning that we've had? And that's all you need in a democratic society, some kind of a leverage for a concerned citizen to enter into the thing. Now, if nobody's concerned, then there's nothing very much I can do. But we do need a grammar for understanding something we feel. And social sciences has that great advantage that we have an immediate understanding of things, howsoever imperfect, because we can experience it, unlike, you know, in the physical sciences or something. You know, I mean, you can see the damn thing, but the process you can't have any clue about because you're not part of the process.
Yes.
In a way, we're all, in some sense, economists. We're all sociologists. We're all anthropologists and so forth. Goes without saying. But it could be very chaotic, imperfect, so imperfect that it doesn't get us very far in coming to grips with what we feel in a deep, visceral sense is happening. And I know people worry hugely when they see, say, a Attenborough program. They come away rather shocked and nervous about the state of the world. So what do they do about it? And as you say, we are, those of us who are children of the Enlightenment, feel that yes, what we need as a minimum is an understanding of what's happening and therefore roots to action. Now, I think I don't worry too much. I think I was sort of probably a sunny disposition. I don't spend sleepless nights worrying about whether what will happen because it's not very productive.
Yes.
It's not that I don't do it because I think it's not productive. It's just I don't do it. And then I say, well, it's a good thing I don't do it because if I did it, it's not going to be very productive anyway. So the causality is somewhat different. But I think that's how it's going to be. At the end of the day, we need an intellectual anchor. And that's what I tried to do in my review. And of course, it's not the end of the story. I'm hoping very much. Cambridge University Press is going to be publishing the full 600-page book by the end of the year, I think. And they got permission from the Treasury. And of course, the Treasury doesn't know its own interest. They can't accept royalties, by the way, the government. Can you believe it? So that there will be some money coming in because graduate students will buy it. So that's okay, fine, because the book will be there permanently on their website. Mm-hmm. That's free of charge. But CUP thought they should still publish it because it'll be a public good. Okay, so they're publishing it. And so I'm hoping very much that graduate students in economics will have access to it, will be encouraged to read it. That will require programs in the graduate schools to encourage them to read it. And if they do, at the end of the day, research students want interesting problems to work on.
Yeah.
Something new to get their head start and, you know, rise up the ladder. We all have this. And there's plenty of stuff on that on the 600-page thing. And if they find different people, find different routes to explore, that'd be good. I'm hoping it does happen that way because without that, it'll be stifled. Mm-hmm. There may be political activity, but not the kind of parallel quantitative economics activity which needs to guide the movements we need. So that part I've done is finished. I think the one thing I would say I feel on the Enlightened project, where I think I've changed my views a little bit, in particular while writing this review that you very kindly asked me to do for Society, your journal, is that I think the Enlightenment didn't quite, for some reason, they haven't taken our place in embeddedness in nature into account. And I don't mean simply, you know, why the growth model doesn't have natural capital. We've discussed that. But that's a technical issue, very important, terribly important, because it's driving our mental picture of the world. But nevertheless, it's a technical thing in the sense. Or so anybody could say, oh, yes, of course, we forgot that. Let's put it in and let's see what happens. It's more that I think our ancient history is missed out in the Enlightenment project. So our ancient history means that we're only 300,000 years old, effectively, roughly speaking, as Homo sapiens. And And of that 100,000 years, the modern humans, if you like, or the social structure of modern humans, is about, 8,000 years old, let's say. I don't know, something like agricultural. That's a blink. And we are carrying in us, all of us, mental capacities which were honed over the long past. And we have the smaller part of it, which comes out in the form of enlightenment, being able to do mathematics. Excuse me for a minute.
Okay.
Can you ring back, please? Thank you. Sorry about that.
It's all right.
When we focus on the fact that we can do Aristotelian logic, that we can do Boolean algebra, we can do the calculus, we can do variational calculus, all the stuff that happens. We're looking at, I think, one aspect of our personality, our abilities. And if we just plug on that, then maybe we're missing something very important. And real understanding requires, if that's the Enlightenment project, then understanding requires that we also understand the impediments to the Enlightenment project. That's one way of putting it, since you use the term, and I think that's quite right. And without that, then the entire Enlightenment project itself is lacking in its, it doesn't have a backbone, because the Enlightenment project said, understand, it's the reason thing. And it's like saying, I have some limitations, which I should be cognizant of before I think in some sense, the blank canvas story of the human person, and that there is therefore unlimited progress out there, is probably a big mistake.
Yes.
That's something I learned mostly from my evolutionary biology friends, and then the work that they've done. Paul Ehrlich, for example, is a good example of somebody who has thought deeply about it and written extensively on it. I don't know how to put this into a coherent complaint, but this is something that I feel quite uneasy about. And here is a simple example, since we are having this long conversation. There is a discipline called subject area called behavioral economics now.
Mm. The whole knowledge thing, yeah.
It's very popular and it's very important. It's good stuff. And it's effectively on they would call it irrational. It's not irrational behavior, but anomalies of behavior from the way the blank canvas story would tell you, logical thinking and so forth. Systematic biases in our reasoning.
Mm.
They have identified quite a number of very interesting ones. So a question that occurs to me and is, if it's systematic, then could it be that we are wired in that direction? And if we are wired in that direction, could it be that we are facing problems 100,000 years ago, or 10,000 years ago, for which it would not have been a bias, but it now looks a bias because we're in a different world we have created? Well, if we can do that, then the advantage is that you can then track what is now to something that we've inherited. It's like capital assets we've carried with us. And that's part of the answer, the worry I was expressing, that the Enlightenment project, in the way it's been pursued, has not seen us as being embedded in time and in nature. I've handled the nature problem, I think, well in my review, But on the time issue, I'm completely innocent. I'm innocent, but I feel there's something there that we need to, we really have to acknowledge.
Yes, I mean, one of the words that you tend to be using more in your articles and even in your talks is you talk about nature as Mother Nature.
Yes.
Which is, in many ways, a very unenlightenment statement, because the Enlightenment took the view, well, that sounds spiritual.
Oh, I see, yes.
You know, and there's a kind of an anti-Enlightenment view there. And I think that was the Enlightenment thought nature is there to be mastered.
Yes.
As a good secularist would do.
Yes.
Not to be respected in that kind of quasi-religious way.
Indeed.
And I think what we're seeing is that has led us down a pretty disastrous...
That's a very nice way of putting it. I hadn't thought about it myself. I wouldn't have put it the way you've done, but I will now do so from now on. You're exactly right. Yes, I don't think I've chosen to call her Mother Nature accidentally. I think it has my culture behind me. You know, the Ganges is Ma Ganga.
Mm.
She's a goddess. Now, we might defile her, but that's a different... But then we say, no, we can't defile her. We think we are defiling her, but she's celestial. How can you pollute the Ganges?
Yes.
So, you know, we rationalize it that way. So we do that. And I think I have an example of it, in this example in the box, actually. And if you read the 600-page thing, you'll find that in one of the boxes, I talk about the Ganges being one of the most polluted rivers, and yet it's, of course, the holiest. But yes, I think I absolutely, no, nature is not there to be mastered, because we are part of nature. She's to be understood, and we need to pay respect to her, because quite apart from anything else, after all, so much of nature is living matter.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not just, non-living particles, it's living matter. So yes, I do have that feeling, absolutely. And I see no reason to change my view on that, because that's how I feel, yes, I do feel when I see, you know, when we were in the Redwoods only 2 weeks ago, my wife and I were doing a bit of road trip after this 2 years confinement, so to speak. If you don't see something like, something about beyond you, in the redwood forest, when, you know, these giants, 1,000 years old, and so forth, and then all the stuff that's underneath your feet and the web of roots and fungi is spread out there down and under, which we're now beginning to understand. If you don't think that's something to be, something beyond you, and I think then you've lost something, you're missing something.
Yes, I agree. I mean, it's that kind of sense of awe that we need to retain. And I think that's why the Romantics went against the Enlightenment, because they said we've lost of something here. I think, you know, the really good people on the Enlightenment, like, actually, I think Isaiah Berlin, one of the reasons I've been so interested in him is that he thought the Romantic reaction to the Enlightenment was a very, very important counterbalance to the Enlightenment. He wasn't anti-Enlightenment, but he felt we're losing something if we just try and implement the Enlightenment project as it is, untamed by a kind of a certain romantic sense of awe with nature and other aspects that aren't assimilable to the Enlightenment project, that could be very narrow.
I hadn't appreciated that at all until you just now mentioned it. I sort of know, of course, of the Romantic movement, or know in the sense of anybody who travels around, but I hadn't put it the way you do it. And if you said that, and you're an expert on Berlin, then all strength to him. He was right, of course. Yeah.
Partha, there was two things. I'm conscious we're going beyond.
No, it's fine. Please go ahead.
Okay, that's very good. Well, there's two things I'd like to maybe finish up on. One is, and it's a subject that's come up quite a bit in this interview, is your wife. And, you know, you've mentioned her quite a few times, most recently there, that giving you that, you know, maybe you need to write a synopsis so that it is understandable by citizens. So maybe could you say something about the importance of your wife in your life, both intellectually and personally?
Well, well, what can I say? Anything I say might sound soppy, and I want to avoid that, because you will notice that when I acknowledged her in my preface, I didn't talk about how without her help I couldn't have written this and so forth. I talked about how she influenced the way I went about it. I met her when she was 19 years old. She just turned 19, and I was, I guess, 23, a bit over 23. I was a graduate student in my first year doing my PhD. She was in the LSE as an undergraduate, first year undergraduate studying international relations. I was going to London to meet my a girl I was going out with, and it was not, I was going to, wanted to end it, and I was feeling very upset about it. It wasn't a good time of my life, so to speak. I was in my personal life. As happens to everybody at some stage, I guess. And she was going to meet her boyfriend in London. Anyway, I happened to sit, came and sat opposite her. And we start, we chatted for a bit. And when we came out of the, I sort of said, look, we can't just say goodbye now. We hadn't actually introduced ourselves. I said, let's go and have something to eat. She said, fine. And so we then made a date. And I think in our first date, I told her we were going to get married.
Wow.
And she said, it was the first proper date. We went to the movies, I think, once. Then we went for a walk, second time we met. So that's why the hurry in my PhD, because we wanted to coordinate and get married and so forth. And she was, in those days, you didn't live together. You know, our parents, both her parents and my parents would have been absolutely, they wouldn't have disowned us, I can assure you. They're themselves enlightenment people, but it would have been a bit of a shock.
Mm.
And we wouldn't have done that. So we got married the day after my PhD oral took place. So yes, she's been, well, what can I say? We have lived now, we've been married for 54 years nearly now, and we met 56 years ago. And before that, I led a peripatetic life as a student, you know, boarding school and so forth. So home for me is my parents, the home in, with my parents in Washington for 3 years. And then a few years before that, when I still lived at home until the age of 11, let's say. And then something to my adding. So I don't know of any other life, as it were. I've never had a sort of a bachelor life, if you see what I mean, mm-hmm. Working bachelor or anything like that. She's been extremely important, of course. Goes without saying, she's shaped my way of life altogether. I like to think I've had some influence over her. We have three children, and she was the one who, she's basically structured our family life completely. I've just been there for the laughs. The children, there's the mother is the one who is really the children, and they like me a lot. I mean, my children like we get on very well. It's not bad, but as they grew older, they saw me more as a person to be bemused by. So they care about what their worries to is Baba all right? Is he because he doesn't know how to look after himself or something? Rather than that, but it's the mother is. And likewise, I depend on her entirely. And so she's been, what can I say? She's sort of, in some sense, the center of my adult life.
Very good. Well, thank you for answering that question. My last question really is one, and when I tend to end these interviews, is to ask you, you know, if you did find yourself in a desert island, what book, piece of music and luxury would you bring with you?
Well, okay, I think I can give you an answer. Yeah, if I'm allowed to. Last few years, I've been really captivated by the ancient poems of the Iliad, of course, the Odyssey. I know them, both of them, quite well. not just them, but also commentaries and so forth. So that's been sort of my leisure reading has been. And the philosopher Bernard Williams, his work on shame and necessity is something I've taken very seriously, because that was going back to the ancients as a source of understanding of the ethical, of ethics. So it would be something that like that. I had sort of ambition of that when I grow older, nothing better to do, or nothing else to do rather. And I would learn Sanskrit well enough to be able to read the Mahabharata in that's the great ancient poem of Brahminic culture. And the Ramayana, I'm not too crazy about Ramayana. It's just too devotional for my liking. The Mahabharata is much more like a Greek. There's a much more greater fusion. But I thought I'd then write a commentary on these, the Iliad and the Mahabharata as two. But that's not going to happen, goes without saying. And I would be daft even trying. It's not my field. But I do read quite a bit along that area. So if I had to take one book, I probably would take the Iliad with me, because it's always worth reading. It's not. If I had to take a philosopher's book, I would, I think, take Bernard Williams's Sense and Shame and Necessity, because I keep on reverting to it every now and then, because I think it is a gem of a work, which has sort of shifted the style of ethical language. And not necessarily that the ethicists have followed it, it's just that I think he was shifting it. But it may not have lasted, but I like what he was doing very much. Music, gosh, that's a hard one. Because I guess I would choose a Western classical piece because of the life that I chose to live, or I have lived, I've lost connection with Indian classical music. I should have listened more to Ravi Shankar, you know, the sitar, the magnificent work. But I would be false in thinking that that's what I would take, because it would be something I don't know well enough. I would take something from my guess is I would take Beethoven piece, largely because some of his slow movements, they have a recurring. Somebody once said one note Ludwig, a very distinguished composer, as a way of showing what a great composer Beethoven was, say he's one note Ludwig. He has only a few notes to play with, but that's what he does. And there is some truth in that. In my way of thinking is that many of his pieces, some of them, say the slow movement, the Fifth Symphony, the second movement, I think, in the Upper Sonata, they have phrases which is almost like the player doesn't know what he's doing next, or the composer himself is unsure as to what the next note is going to be, or the set of notes. So it's almost like kind of when I think about when I work, I don't know where my pencil is going to lead to, because I work and I don't know the theorem, I'm groping. And this exploratory sense of the creative process, or inquiring, not creative is not the right word for me, it's just inquiring, is something I find very interesting. And I find that in Beethoven. So it would be a Beethoven piece.
Okay.
Whether it would be a piano sonata or a piano concerto or a symphony, I don't know, but it could be one. And what other thing did you have?
The last was a luxury.
Luxury? Aha. Do you know, I don't think, certainly not a clothing or food or anything like that. I'm very eclectic about that. Anything is good enough. If I'm hungry, I'll eat anything. I'll probably take a detective book.
Oh, okay. a Le Carre or something more less highbrow?
No, the once I I go to the movies a lot. I mean, movies are something of huge importance in my life. I've spent thousands of movies over a lifetime. I'm a child of my time, I guess. Of course, Agatha Christie, I've read her, because she puts you sort of, you know, it's the thing you want to take to bed so you can go to sleep. I've gone through Chandler very well, and he's marvelous. I like Lee Child now very much.
Oh, yeah.
So I've read him quite a bit. He has both style and, he's a stylish writer. Very. So I think I'd probably take some. That would be a luxury.
You could have the collected works of Lee Child, which is quite a lot.
That's a lot.
It'll keep you going. Well, Partha, thank you very much. I've really enjoyed talking to you, and it's been a real honor as well. So thank you very much.
Not at all. It's a great pleasure. And you've raised many thoughts, which I probably have not really articulated before. So I've gained much from this interview, and it was a pleasure to get to see you. And I hope very much we'll keep in touch.